taken by other seniors present over here, medical friends and all. At the outset, let me accept the fact that the entire work, or the mainly all the work done on the questions as far as the drafting and the answers, etc., the entire credit goes to Abhitan, where he has been kind enough to share his knowledge, and we finalized some of the questions. The answers, the only thing is we have a negative marking which Ketanbhai forgot to give. So by evaluating yourself, if there is a wrong answer, you have to give minus one. If there is a right answer, you can take one mark for that. So we have allocated one mark. So out of 24, you have to allocate yourself, and accordingly you have to evaluate. You can send for evaluation if required. Nearby is over here. Let us see what he can do after the evaluation. Let us come to the questions. The questions, I understand, they have been circulated now for the reason that circulated few minutes back, for the reason that there is no chance of any copying and all that. However, nevertheless, few of them have already been discussed during the entire course of the seminar. Let us understand how present you were that time and whether you have understood what the speaker wanted to say, and the answer to that you are able to give the correct answer to that. So the first question, if he straight away take up his ICDS will apply to which of the following SSEs? All the SSEs are following mercantile system of accounting. One, resident individual having tax, who is covered under tax audit under section 44AB. Second, non-resident individual who is covered under tax audit under 44AB. Third, resident partnership firm covered under tax section, covered under tax audit. And fourth, resident, not covered under tax audit. Let me repeat that again, a resident partnership firm not covered under 44AB, resident HUF who is also not covered under tax audit. The options are already given whether the answer to 1, 2, 3, 4 are correct. Now the answer is for the one resident individual who is covered under tax audit, yes, ICDS is applicable. Non-resident individual also, if he is covered in tax audit, so there is no difference between a resident and a non-resident, it's on the same lines. The third one, a resident partnership firm tax audit, if he is not applicable, in that case ICDS is not applicable, ICDS is still applicable to them. And the fourth, if an HUF, or let me just extend it, HUF or an individual who is not covered under tax audit, the ICDS provisions are not applicable to them. And this originally, friends, while the small confusion is that originally when these provisions were introduced, it was made applicable to all SSEs who are having the income under business heads and the income from other sources. And after the notification which has been issued dated 29, that is when the ICDSs have been notified, at that time they have clarified about this, that it will be applicable to individual and HUF only in case where they are covered under tax audit. So the next question leads to, does ICDS impact the computation of income under the provisions of MAT or AMT? Option, yes, ICDS will impact computation of MAT and AMT, that is to both. No, ICDS will not impact computation to either of them. Third, ICDS will only impact computation of MAT and it will not impact computation of AMT. And fourth, ICDS will only impact computation of AMT and it will not impact the computation of MAT. Readily, any answer from the audience? Sorry? B. Oh, majority, or all are right, I think so. So you can take one mark, yeah. The third one is, in case there is a conflict between the provisions of Act or rules and rules and ICDS, which provision will prevail? Is it the provisions of ICDS that will prevail over the Act and rules? Is it the provisions of Act and rules will prevail over the ICDS? is it the provisions of ICDS will prevail over the provisions of rule, but Act will not prevail over the provisions of ICDS, and provisions of ICDS will prevail over provisions of the Act, but rule will prevail over provisions of ICDS? Sorry?
B.
Okay. I'm good to learn that, yes, you all were present during the day. The only why this question has been raised was in the preamble of all the ICDS, everywhere it is mentioned that the provisions of the Act will prevail in case of contradiction. As far as the rules, they have come out by way of a clarification, by way of FAQ questions to question number 4, which has been issued in the month of March, wherein it says that Act or rules, rules also, the rules will prevail instead of the ICDS provision. Which of the following statements are true in relation to ICDS 1, that is accounting policies? ICDS 1 is silent on, ICDS 1 is silent on materiality and prudence.
Yes.
One?
Yes.
You have read the questions or the answers, I don't know, answer repeat me, no, okay. So, yeah. Anyway, the answer to one is right, it is silent, but however, we have understood that yes, how does the prudence can prevail at times? It is inbuilt by the first speaker did explain to us on that. Now, coming to the next question, that is disclosure requirements of ICDS is applicable to. Option, all assesses to whom ICDS applies. Only to the assessee to whom ICDS applies and are liable for tax audit. Companies, all assessees other than individual HF to whom ICDS applies. Little confusion as far as what Yogesh Bhai in his presentation had given. Okay, before that, let us give the answer first. It's B, rightly so. B. Only to the assessees to whom ICDS applies and are liable for tax audit. The reason is, in our ITR, that is the income tax returns, there is no way that you can have a disclosure. The ICDS, only the effects of the ICDS are to be given. But as far as the tax audit is concerned, you need to comply with both, that is the effect as well as the disclosure part.
But suppose
the
case is taken up for scrutiny and you are submitting the balancing,
but
you are not declared accounting
policy,
what will happen?
Nothing at that time you can give, if at all required. But see, the question is whether you are required to give. You are not required to give.
We can be silent.
Sorry?
Exactly, but they have clarified in the FAQ that if it is not, you are not liable to tax audit, then the disclosure is not applicable to you. So question number 25 specifically clarified this. So only they are restricted it to the people to whom tax audit is applicable.
May I request members to avoid the machines? Because you know, we are actually running short of time. We have to vacate this premises by 6:04.
Okay. The question number 6, for the purpose of ICDS 3 construction contract, which of the following statements are true? Alright, the answer to that is right. B, 1, 2 and 4 are to be covered for the purpose of ICDS 3. Will ICDS 3, they are simple ones. Construction contract applied to a 3-year construction. Which?
No.
Yes or no?
No.
Correct? No. The 8th one is as per ICDS 3. I hope everybody is with us. A group of them, I think they have read the questions. I must appreciate that's very nice of them. Young group is there, but let us understand all the oldies are also there, all the seniors, let me take it there. The answer to that is, of course, the 8 is C. I will take the last one and thereafter I will request Abhitan. Those are little complicated ones, so I have taken the easier ones. Let Abhitan take the complicated ones. The question number 9. On July 1st, 16, Mr. Ahas invested 10 lakhs in a bond of 12%. carrying an interest at the rate of 12%. Coupon date is 30th June and 31st of December. For the previous year ended 31st March 17, interest income of Mr. A as per ICDS revenue C, you say 90 rupees. Whether let us understand the reason why this 90 rupees is. What is the period of calculation? Not this side, the other side. 1st July to 31st of March and not 1st July to 31st of December, though the due date when you will be receiving would be after the March, so you need to calculate based on the period or the time that that is what the ICDS provisions are missing. Now I would request Abhitan with only one more request that if the speaker differs with our answers, he is allowed to say, and rather he is allowed to enlighten all of us if there is any variation from the answers what we have been giving. Yeah, Abhita.
Good evening. Question 10. So, Mr. A has specifically borrowed 10 lakh rupees at 15% rate of interest on April 1 for a construction of fixed asset. Payment to the seller for fixed asset has been made in May 1, 16. So basically, when will the capitalization of borrowing cost start? So whether it would be date of payment or date of borrowing, because it being a specific borrowing, as rightly said, it will start from the date of borrowing. So answer is C. Now question 11. I'll briefly say what is the question. There is a concept of suspension of borrowing cost to be capitalized in accounting standard. That is when a construction of asset has been commenced, but due to some unforeseen reasons it has stopped. So you even stop capitalization of borrowing cost. But there is no such concept in ICDS. So whether do you need to continue or you need to bring in the concept of accounting standard into ICDS. So as nothing is provided, you have to continue. Then whether bank guarantee is covered as borrowing cost which you give to get a loan. Generally for foreign loans, your holding company gives a corporate guarantee so that the rate of interest is less and you reimburse that corporate guarantee. So the definition of borrowing cost specifically says includes cost incurred in connection with the borrowing. So the guarantee cost which you are incurring is to get a lower interest rate, so it is in connection with the borrowing, so it would be part of the borrowing cost. Then 13, qualifying asset for capitalization of borrowing cost would not only include qualifying asset acquired during the year, but also the opening value of work in progress of a qualifying asset. Obviously, it doesn't matter whether the qualifying is acquired asset is acquired during the year or it was acquired in earlier year. So answer is yes, true. Then question 14. What is the method of recognition of government grant which is there in ICDS as compared to accounting standard has a method that if it is capital grant, then it is directly credited to capital reserve. But as we have understood today, as per ICDS, that is given a go-by. You have to account it as an income over the period in which, if there is an expense, then over the period when expense is incurred or upfront.
So third is
the answer. So securities, ICDS 8 on securities applies to stock and trade or investment. It applies to stock and trade. Then for a firm trading in commodities market, will ICDS 8 on securities apply to commodity derivatives held as stock and trade?
No,
because definition of securities specifically exclude derivatives.
Now,
yes. Question 17. How are assets, various securities held as stock and trade or fixed asset, which are acquired in exchange of other assets, recognized? So, fair value of the asset. Received or transferred?
Received.
You are telling transferred, you are telling received. It is D. It is also following a Supreme Court decision in case of George Anderson, which is also incorporating both the ICDS, ICDS on securities and as well as ICDS on fixed assets.
D for Delhi.
Would actual cost of shares held as stock in trade include the amount paid as securities transaction tax? Yes, no?
Yes.
Why no?
Part of
see, basically first, irrespective of ICDS, you have 145A, which says that all the tax duties are to be included. Further, ICDS also says that any cost incurred in relation to acquisition of cost of asset, including tax censuses, are to be added. So security transaction tax is to be added as cost of asset. Then, which of the method is permitted by ICDS-2, we'll take it otherwise, which method is not permitted by ICDS-2 out of the four methods, which are FIFO, standard cost, FIFO and weighted average.
LIFO
is not permitted. Right. Then question 20. Then for the purpose of ICDS-5, tangible fixed asset, which of the following statements are true? First is expenditure incurred on startup and commission of a project, including expenditure on test runs and experimental production, is to be capitalized. Yes, no?
Yes.
True. Second, ICDS-5 does not recognize the concept of materiality. In companies that you have a capital asset of less than 5,000 can be directly written off. Is there anything in ICDS?
No.
Third, fair value of an asset. This we have already seen, it is a repetition that value of asset acquired has to be considered. Sir, question?
Before he comes to 21, can we go back to question number 19? I purposely coming back to question number 19 that LIFO cannot be followed. And I'm taking this again because of we had a discussion just yesterday before one of our members did have a doubt that, okay, a SSE who is consistently following a LIFO system, what happens now? Whether he can be allowed under ICDS, if yes, then there is no issue. If no, then what happens? Is he supposed to revise his opening stock also? Based on the, supposing now he has decided to follow FIFO system. Is he supposed to do that also?
No.
So opening stock, he will continue with LIFO system and the closing stock, maybe whichever is better, standard costing, FIFO or weighted average, either of them he will have to convert and change. So that to that extent, there is a change in accounting policy.
And question 21. Premium discount on forward contracts entered into for trading speculative purpose need to be recognized at year end or settlement, or answer is C, at the time of settlement. Then question 22. As per ICDS-6, exchange difference arising from restatement of foreign currency loan taken for acquiring asset in India, what should be the treatment for that? Okay.
I think very clearly explained. All the last two, I think three questions, the lastly what Nihar bhai has taken, the answers are very clear over here, and I think that is very fresh to you.
Yes, but still few
to completeness,
are,
yeah.
Few people are answering, it is A. The question is, asset is acquired in India. Sir specifically said that 43A is only applicable to asset acquired outside India. So, A is not applicable, 43A is not applicable, so answer would be B, that it has to be recognized as income or expenditure.
This asset acquired from country outside India,
okay.
Not asset acquired outside India.
Question 23. How is provision to be recognized in ICDS, whether it has to be a probable, reasonable certainty or virtual certainty? Sir clearly has specified it has to be reasonable certainty. And similarly, the last question is, when is a contingent asset should be recognized, whether probable certainty, reasonable certainty or virtual certainty? That is again reasonable certainty for ICDS. Thank you all.
Yeah. I think we, in the required time, we are able to complete.
Yes.
So, thank you very much.
Well, friends, of course, just the closing remarks.